fine as you are, baby, a rumor that you were a man was absurd to me. It was insane.
Well, after having a daughter, my mother had to defend that rumor, for example.
But before the daughter, I knew you were a woman, baby.
Ooh. I've got some fans out here.
Today we are talking about none other than Donna Summer. And I know you know her song. Everybody has done a rendition of her song. She was a disco queen. My favorite from her, although it should not be for my little age. I can't believe I heard this song. But it's the Love to Love You Baby. That song right there is crazy. The 16-minute version is just... it's just crazy. And in the last years of her life, she was not singing that song at all for anybody because it would cause riots, it would cause fights in the auditorium. Basically, it's just her climaxing throughout the whole song. But she was known for that, and also lived her life pretty much controversy free with just a little bit of things that we're going to talk about. But she had a beautiful, beautiful, triumphant life, in my opinion. And I just love Donna Summer so much. She was giving, and I think in a biopic, SZA or maybe Kelly Rowland could play her in a biopic. But she gives me, SZA gives me the Donna Summer vibe a little bit, but a little bit more modern with her own twist. And Kelly Rowland just has the physique, the aura that Donna Summer has, you know what I mean? But without further ado, let's jump in. If you cannot tell, I'm excited. But Donna Summer was an American singer, songwriter, and actress. She gained prominence during the disco era of the 1970s and became known as the Queen of Disco, while her music gained a global following. So Summer earned a total of 42 hit singles on the Billboard Hot 100 in her lifetime, with 14 of those reaching the top 10. The five-time Grammy winner was a force to be reckoned with throughout her musical career. Although she passed out at the young age of 63 is so young, guys, and she passed away in 2012, her legacy lives on through her legendary music that defined an era of counterculture and, of course, extravagance and glamour. So LaDonna Adrian Gaines was born on December 31st, 1948 in Boston, Massachusetts, to Andrew and Mary Gaines, and was third of seven children. She was raised in a Boston neighborhood of Mission Hill. Her father was a butcher and her mother was a school teacher. So Donna suffered from childhood depression in her youth, and in her memoir, which I suggest everybody get, it's really, really nice. If you're a LaDonna fan, Donna Summer fan, I would suggest it. She's very open with herself in there. So the book is titled Ordinary Girl, and Donna wrote, and I quote, "I was always the type of person to dive into things, literally and figuratively, regardless of whether or not I fully knew what I was getting into." This sentiment can be seen throughout the adventures of her life, but it started when she literally jumped into a pool and almost drowned at the age of 8. So her brothers and sisters pulled her out. She had no idea how long she was unconscious, but remembered when she came back to life that she believed that God had saved her and had a special plan for her in her life. With a new sense of purpose, she did pray, and she asked God to please teach me how to sing better. So at the age of 7, she accidentally cut a large gash in her cheek on a kitchen chair her father was repairing. And it left a scar that for her entire childhood made her feel very insecure and ugly. So she wore wigs trying to hide it. And for years, she was bullied and teased by her siblings and her neighbors. And this did trigger, you know, some more sadness and depression for her. And she also experienced bedwetting and an obsessive need for perfection. She saw a therapist until she was 16 years old. So I'm glad that at least in her, but that's rare, especially in this day, at that time, guys, y'all don't understand. At that time, around the 1950s, definitely for a black family to bring their child to therapy until she's 16, that is beautiful to hear, for me at least, you know, that's rare also. So while Summer laments that this time in her life, she also claimed it helped her to develop a sense of humor and a strong desire to prove herself. So Summer's performance debut occurred at church when she was 10 years old, and she was replacing a vocalist who failed to show up. So she attended Boston Jeremiah E. Burke High School, where she performed in school musicals and was considered popular. And in 1967, just weeks before graduation, Donna Summer left for New York City, where she joined the blues rock band Crow. After a record label passed on signing the group, since it was only interested in the band's lead singer, the group agreed to dissolve. So Donna Summer was becoming Donna Summer and was coming more into herself, but not without some little strange happenings. Let's talk about this. So in order to play nightclubs and attend practice, Summer skipped school. One time she witnessed a group of boys attacking an elderly woman, okay? The woman was left unconscious and not even breathing, so she performed CPR on her until an ambulance arrived. Later, Summer learned the woman had died and that the cops were looking for witnesses. Summer was scared to come forward because she thought she'd get in trouble for being a truant, like, you know, skipping school. And I got in trouble for truancy too, but we're not gonna talk about that. Her conscience got the best of her, though, thankfully, and Summer decided to talk to the police. She told an officer the names of the boys and exactly what she saw, and the boys were arrested, and Summer was called to testify in court. That happened to me, too. That's so strange. And though the boys were found guilty and sent to prison, they had friends who threatened Summer, making her feel unsafe in her own neighborhood. So 3 weeks before graduating high school, she moved with her band to New York to further her career, but also get out of Boston, you know, so she didn't complete that graduation year. So then LaDonna started becoming LaDonna, and she was dropping records. I want you guys to call me a favorite song. Like I said, Love to Love You is my favorite song. And not just Love to Love You, but I also like, she has hits like She Work Hard for Her Money, and then I Feel Loved. Oh, comment below your favorite Donna Summer song. And if you don't have a favorite, this is your first time watching this, go educate yourself. But let's talk about, sadly, how in the rise of her career, people put out rumors that she was a man because of her features. And this is where a lot of women, black women specifically, talk about featureism, especially in the specter of YouTube, you know. And you guys saw the clip of Arsenio Hall interview with her when he was basically complimenting her, like, I knew you were a woman. And I love Arsenio Hall for that. I do want to do a breakdown for him too, so y'all comment below if y'all want that. It's not just because of that, but throughout his show and his career, for the most part, when he interviewed especially dark-skinned black women on his show, he always, you know, showcased them in a desirable and respectful way. And his whole interview with Donna Summer was very interesting and flirty. It was cute to watch. But it is sad that he had to reassure her, as well as other people, because Donna Summer was very well respected in the industry. And though she spent most of her life in Germany too, and not even in America, and I don't blame her, all the black community really loved Donna Summer and respected her. But you had a lot of men, black men, in the industry also, and you have white men that really tried to just break her confidence, and it never broke her confidence. She still remained Donna Summers and still had a sensual aura about her, kind of like a glamorous Sade or Cher. And Cher was, a lot of people was inspired by Donna Summer, from Selena, Madonna, Cher, like a lot of these women, Donna Summer paved the way for her, okay? It's sad that she had to deal with this because her face, she had the bigger full lips, and I find her facial structure really beautiful. She's one of the most beautiful women, especially in that era. I find the way her nose structure go up with her eyes and her eyebrows is very beautiful in an Avatar-esque way. Very beautiful features that you wouldn't normally see like that. So it's very unfortunate, the ignorance that she dealt with that time. But this still happened today, like Meg Thee Stallion, a lot of people was calling her a man when Tory allegedly did what he did. People did this to Michelle Obama. Like, a lot of women in the black community go through this. And I know y'all don't like Wendy, but y'all know I like Auntie Wendy, and people do that to Wendy. Any black woman that's a little bit taller, that has a little bit more, I don't know what you deem masculine features, but that doesn't have the typical generic, you know, European soft, quote-unquote soft features, was deemed men and masculine. So that rumor went around, and she basically used her pregnancies, well, her mother and those close around her used her pregnancies and things like that as proof, to the point where a lot of black women at that time had to prove that they were women. It didn't matter how feminine they were, and she just exudes feminine aura. So that was very upsetting. I was very upset, you know, to know that she had to endure that. And she even had to speak on that. And women alike had to speak on that. And featureism still plagues us today. And I just request that people just stop with the ignorance, okay? Okay. So according to the Globe and Mail, Donna Summer started dating Helmuth Summer, who is a Vietnamese actor she met in Berlin while doing hair. The couple rekindled their friendship when they were both cast in the Hamburg production of the Me Nobody Knows. The two went on to perform in other productions together, and when their final tour was over, they went home to Vienna, where Sommer asked Donna to marry him. So they married in 1972, and soon after, Donna discovered she was pregnant. In her memoir, she described a morning she was rushed to the hospital by her husband. A doctor told her she was in danger of having a miscarriage, and the couple decided to move to Donna's parents' apartment, where Donna remained on bed rest for the remainder of her pregnancy. And in February 1973, Donna gave birth to her first daughter, Mimi. The year following the birth of her daughter, Donna Summer dived into a deep depression once again. So it just followed her throughout her life. She felt unprepared for motherhood, which is normal feelings that mothers go through. Her husband worked a lot, so he wasn't home, and he was leaving her home alone to care for the child a lot of the times. So she felt a little neglected. She didn't go out or sing anymore. In her memoir, she said she felt isolated. And Donna turned to a friend she only refers to in her book as Anna. Anna taught her to bathe Mimi and how to get her to sleep. And through Anna, Summer met a man she only refers to as Gunther. Gunther was a painter and what Summer described as a wild man, so she was attracted to him instantly. And desperate to move out of her depressed state, Donna and Helmuth temporarily separated. So Summer then moved in with Anna and often saw Gunther. And Gunther, being a married man, also, okay, Donna, confided in Summer, and she with him. So after many long talks combined with many glasses of wine, the two crossed over from friends to lovers. As reported by the ABC News, her husband, who she was separated from, learned of the affair and confronted Donna. They made their separation official and divorced. Donna kept Helmut's last name Sommer, but changed it to Summer, because his name was S-O-M-M-E-R, so she changed it to Summer. I wonder if that's what inspired Summer Walker's name. Maybe she was trying to have that Donna Summer-esque, I don't know, but not disco. Who knows? So Donna Summer knew Gunther could be violent and angry when he, you know, was under the influence. That's the guy that she's cheating with, Gunther, that, you know, was having an affair with. He apparently had a drinking problem, so he wasn't any better. So she tried to keep her distance, but had come to rely on him for emotional support in her career and motherhood. And according to her memoir, when she tried to leave him, he kicked in her bathroom door, slapped her, and threw her into a glass cabinet. Her skin and hair was covered in shards. She knew she would break up with him, but was afraid to be alone. And this plagues women a lot. Summer continued dating Gunther for years, even after becoming an international success. In 1997, Summer met Brooklyn Dream singer Bruce Sudano, which would become her final husband. And while living in Los Angeles, they were drawn to each other. But like her, he was also in a committed relationship. So she was with Gunther. It looked like Donna Summers. I love you, girl. But she didn't know how to end one before she jumped into a new one. I don't know, sis. Let's talk about it. So after going out with Sudano and his band, Gunther asked Summer where she'd been, of course. She said, before I could say anything, he grabbed me, threw me up against the wall, and proceeded to slap me around. She went on to say he threw me into the laundry room where he continued to hit on her. I fell into a heap and Gunther disappeared. After a moment, he returned with a pistol in his hands. He was ready to take her life. He just had a feeling, I guess. Gunther was charged and was deported. So Summer said, battered, bruised, and beaten nearly to death, I realized that God had come to my rescue yet again. She took time to heal and waited for Sudano to break up with his girlfriend. In 1978, Summer showed up at Sudano's doorsteps and shot her shot, honey, and she confessed her love to him. The two married on July 16th, 1980. So in 1976, while living at the Navarro Hotel in New York City, Donna Summer thought about how the world was caving in on her. And between the men in her life at the time, Gunther and Summer, and her career obligations, Summer felt she had no power over her own life. She walked to the hotel's window and put her leg on the sill. It got caught in the drapes just as a maid walked in. In an interview with Mary Hart, Summer said this disruption helped her to snap out of it. Within 24 hours, Summer did see a therapist, so I love her relationship with therapists as well. And that's a lesson we can learn from her life story. Don't be afraid to go to a therapist. And the therapist helped her to understand that the culture shock of moving from one continent to another was enough stress for anyone. She was put on medication to help her focus, but it made it hard for her to sleep. So she decided what she really needed was to work on her relationship with God. And soon after, she became a born-again Christian. The gay club scene was coming of age just as Donna Summer's star was rising. Her openly erotic and easy to dance to music became iconic in the community. And when her career declined in the early 80s, just as disco started to die, her gay fans remained her most loyal fans. Jim Feldman, writer for The Village Voice, wrote a review of Summer's comeback concert in Atlantic City in 1983. Where he alleged that she said, and it turned out to be a lie, he alleged that she said, and I quote, "It's Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. I've seen the evil homo, you know, come out of you people. AIDS is the result of your sins. Now, don't get me wrong, God loves you, but not the way you are now." End quote. She denied the comments and tearfully lamented her loss of friends to the AIDS epidemic. She said many people she worked with in the music business were gay, and she would never make those kinds of remarks. But people wouldn't believe her until it was too late. The Huffington Post states that her 1989 performance at Boston Pride Parade was protested by the AIDS activist organization ACT UP. She sent them a letter asking them to forgive her. She claims it took her so long to respond to the accusation because she gave birth to her other two daughters. So she'd just given birth when these rumors came out and was busy with life. Her connection to the community has been tainted since, with some choosing to forgive her and others not. And on May 17, 2012, Donna Summer died at home in Naples, Florida at age 63 from lung cancer. According to Rolling Stone, no one knew she had cancer except for her immediate family and few close friends. She said she wanted to keep it hidden, so she lived as a recluse the year before. Chemotherapy made her lose a lot of weight, and if anybody saw her, it would be obvious she was sick. In the LA Times, Rachel Schwartz from the Lung Cancer Foundation of America said it was typical for people with lung cancer to shy away from telling others because of the stigma of smoking. People reported that her family wanted to make it clear her cancer was not due to smoking. While alive, Summer told people it was caused by the asbestos in the air from the fall of the Twin Towers on 9/11. Instead of taking Summer and her family at their word, though, many have openly debated whether or not she got cancer from asbestos or smoking. And according to Ammo Mama, it was even in an episode of Autopsy, The Last Hours Of, a show where the cause of death is explored. The host, Dr. Michael Hunter, stated, "While it is likely she was exposed to debris following the attack, it was not likely she would have gotten cancer from it. Many believed it was from smoking when she was younger and singing in smoke-filled clubs. Also, lung cancer ran in her family, taking the life of both her mother and younger sister." The Rock and Roll Hall of Fame states at the 2013 Rock and Roll Hall of Fame ceremony, Donna Summer was inducted by Kelly Rowland, who I've been saying should play her, singer of Destiny's Child. You all know who Kelly Rowland is. She was recognized as an inspiration for Madonna, Beyonce, and the entire EDM movement. The Hall of Fame went on to say she was no producer's puppet, but a collaborator, writer, and innovative artist in her own right. Summer worried her talents wouldn't be fully recognized until after she died, that people would put her in a box as a sex symbol and a mere relic of the disco era. And sadly, she was right. She did deserve better. Her death didn't get the same recognition Prince or Michael or Whitney or any of these people got, when she was by far one of the most renowned artists, especially black artists, blacks excellent of that time. And I do sadly believe it was because of those lies and rumors about what she said about the LGBTQ community. And we know when the LGBTQ community cancels you, you're canceled for good, honey. So she couldn't even get her just due in the end, even though most people now recognize and realize those were lies and she never said those. So it's very unfortunate, but it's never too late to give her her flowers. Let's give her her flowers now. Make sure to like and comment your favorite song. Show some love in the comments. Share with a friend. Comment below who else you guys would like to see. I love you guys. Until next time.